Yeah, hi. Fredrik Söderblom, I'm from a company called StoredSafe. I'm here to talk to you about modern email security. So let's do a raise of hands. How many of you are actually involved in administrating an MTA today? 10 people, okay, cool. How many of you have SPF set up? All of you? And keep your hand raised if you have set it up correctly. I have statistics that says you haven't. How many of you are using DKIM for signing email? Good. Anybody in here using Office 365? Oh, that's, yeah, okay. Anybody in here having customers using Office 365? Cool. I'll give you a couple of hints at the end. Why most likely most of their email will get rejected when they'll start using DMARC due to some foresights or mishaps and how to fix it. So that's me. I started out running my own company, so let's see, 2002. XPD, we focus on IT security, so that's basically my main line of work. We've been doing audits in the US and Europe, IT security audits, which basically led us to creating a Swedish startup that deals with cryptography, because basically this was one of the things that we see all the time when doing audits, especially in the US, that people really don't have a good way of sharing and storing secrets like passwords. So typically we hit the customer and they have the same passwords on 300 routers and switches. So basically we made a Swedish startup that basically solved this problem, an enterprise-wide password manager. But today's agenda is not about that, it's about email. I'll try to give you a bit of motivation why this would be at least on the top spot of the agenda of some of your companies that you're working with, or your customers. We'll talk a little bit about mitigations. How can you actually try to stop the evilness that can happen? A little bit about future. Well, as you can see, there's a lot of problems. We'll talk about them. I'll try to highlight them. But there's also the situation today, as we see them with phishing, whaling, malware, it's not really necessary. There has been means to stop it rather effectively, or at least minimize the problems of it for several years now. People just don't use it. And I also propose an action plan to actually mitigate the situation. So, what's the big fuss? It's just mail, right? The problem, this is the problem. There's 100 billion emails every single day. 100 billion, that's a lot of emails. Well, just mail. Well, the problem is, it is, has been, and still is, one of the major threat vectors. This is why this is interesting for me, doing IT security. This is the main reason for my companies, my customers, to get infected and to have problems. Problems that can range from a single workstation not working. Could be okay, unless it's some part of a SCADA system. Or it could actually be like Maersk, where they had to reinstall 4,500 servers, 15,000 clients over 10 days. They lost $300 million over those 10 days. And that was just for malware that basically, in a few couple of minutes, wiped out their network or their servers. What the real problem is, as you all are already familiar with. The problem is this. Our users, our customers, their clients, Lisa, Henrik, working over at economics or order entry or a sales guy, they can't ID, they can't spot the fake. It's getting increasingly harder as well, but this is basically the problem. We are throwing the cool, the fun stuff at the problem. All the stuff over here, electronics and stuff. But the problem is really this, human error. So the short version of today's talk was basically be that if we could educate our users, none of this would have been necessary at all. You wouldn't need to have any type of anti-malware or anything on your computers, more or less, if you could educate your users correctly. That's an utopia. So basically, what I'm trying to suggest is that you always have to have a mix of education and technology. We tend to ignore the people fact, but that's a very, very important part of it. And this is from HIPAA journal. HIPAA, how many is all familiar with HIPAA in here? A few working in healthcare? Okay. It's basically an act in the US that says that if a hospital loses one single piece of electronic health information, patient data, they take the IT manager, just lift him up and drop him down on Riker Island for 3 years of prison. That's how you deal with bad email or bad security in the US when it comes to hospitals. I did audits over in the US back in 2003, before HIPAA was in effect. And for them, it really worked, because the difference for US hospitals before and after HIPAA is an order of magnitude. But as HIPAA journal confirms, email is still the top attack vector. If you can see from SANS, a little snippet here, email road is most of the malware into organization. This is kind of interesting. We kind of use that, we tell people, oh, watch out for the attachments of your email. Well, what's been on the rise lately is basically not that. It's phishing or whaling and that type of stuff. And you can see from 2nd quarter and 3rd quarter in 2018, it's slightly old figures. And these figures are actually from Proofpoint. So phishing through email has been on the rise. It looks like this. So the red one is basically malicious attachments. And the blue one is malicious URL messages. So something is happening here. We're still using email as an attack vector. This is also kind of very interesting figures. The gray, the red area here is what you think you're protecting your users from with anti-malware. That's just 10% of the blocked attacks contains that type of threat to your organization. 90% of the blocked attacks actually contains impersonation, whaling, spear phishing. The W-2 fraud is that's a US tax form. So typically, what can we see? We see emails coming out to you, me, your customers, your aunt, your parents, with links to fill in information. So that's one of the major problems, okay? So let's talk through the mitigations. So how can we actually try to mitigate it, try to stop it as early as possible, make it harder to fool people? So this is typically what I show to management type of board, etc., to explain the stupidity of the SMTP protocol. Hands up for anybody that loves SMTP. No, it's a really stupid protocol. It's in the order of idiocy as the SIP protocol. It's really extremely stupid. designed back when everybody was good, more or less. Well, a good example of that would be like the SUXI backdoor into sendmail that Eric Allman had in back in the original source code. That really wouldn't work that well today. So this is basically an overview of the main problem. The main problem with SMTP is that we have different types of sender from addresses. So we have one on the actual envelope. It's called RFC 5321, mail from field. And we have a different from within the actual email, the RFC 5322 address. I'll just move to the other side, Johan. Just attach the, or change the camera, I guess. So in more technical details, because I think this is more of a technical audience, this is what we see. So typically, in the SMTP protocol, we have one mail from that's part of the protocol specification. And then you have another from, which is within the actual email body. So parts of the mitigations. And we'll talk through all of these. So let's start by examining the problem, or actually two problems at the same time. This is actually bound for destruction, doing two things at the same time. So can you see at the back? Read the text? Okay, good. So this is basically just using something similar, Netcat or Telnet. You can speak to any SMTP server out there. This is more of a surprise for other type of audience, but let's walk through it anyway. So SMTP is a nice protocol in terms that you can simulate it with Telnet or Netcat. It's not like H323 or something. That's a binary protocol. So here's an evil guy. He's contacting the mail server at smtpcorp.com. He says that the mail is from, well, basically his own address. This is kind of fine, because that address won't be used for anything besides checks. He says that the mail should go to Tom. And the mail server says, yeah, sure, go ahead. So that's describing the first problem. And the second problem is basically this: transmitting stuff in clear text. This is clearly not good. If you are a dissident working in China or North Korea or something. So any trained eye could easily understand that all of this text could have easily been manipulated by a man in the middle. So that's the second problem. So let's look at the first problem. So basically, the evil guy, he started by using the mail from up here. He said, who's the mail to? And then when he's formulating the email, he says, the mail is actually from John Doe, john@corp.com. And this is actually the address that will be shown in the email client. And, Tom, what's your stance on new employee benefit program? And a link, probably giving an opportunity to enter his account details or something, or authentication, so we can steal it. This is actually almost part of a real campaign that we've been using at customers. Can somebody guess how many people will actually click this link when it looks like this? Say again? Half? Higher. 70% clicks this link. 70%. We've done it on hospitals with over 10,000 employees. Say again? Oh, okay. So as you can see, the effect of such an easy spoofing is kind of scary. For to Tom, this actually looks like a perfect email from his buddy John. So to fix the second problem, where we had clear text, we have start TLS. Almost anyone running a fairly modern MTA today has support for start TLS. So start TLS is something that the server can announce that I support TLS. If it's supported, we can use it. The client can say, okay, let's switch to a binary encrypted protocol. and no one can see the text and no one can mess with it. So this is the right type of audience. What's the cardinal error with this setup? Perfect. So the answer was, you can man in the middle because this is clear text, and you can remove the 250 start TLS, and then the client will just do plain text. So start TLS took care of the encryption problem, sort of. It's not a perfect solution. There's remedy to that as well, coming later. Sadly, those parts are still in draft mode, but at least it looks a bit brighter on the horizon. So, but why? Why on earth can anyone send email from any domain? Well, SPF to the rescue. SPF is published in DNS. Very shortly, this is just doing dig on the SPF records for evildoer.com. Basically, this record says something. What does it say? Yeah. So it basically says anybody that actually is part of the MX record for this domain are authorized to send email as evildoer.com. The minus all at the end, what does it mean? Yeah, a tilde all. If you have a tilde and all or a question mark, isn't that the same then? Yep. So this is the proper way of doing it. Minus all, this is the way it should look like. That's a hard fail. So if an email arrives, it can't pass validation. Minus all ensures a hard fail. Anything else is crap. Should be used for a limited time for testing. So that this is the sorry state of SPF in Sweden on the SE domain. This is data from late 2016. This is doing on almost 1 million domains. So only 160,000 of those domains deployed SPF. The rest were out, didn't have an SPF record. Out of those 16%, how many managed to actually create a correct SPF record? It wasn't all that complicated, was it? You saw it in the previous example. How many? A guess, a wild guess. 1%, that's too low. That's just evil. But I like it. So another guess. 160,000 domains. How many are correctly configured? No, sorry, too high. 6%, sorry. 6% out of those 160,000, out of those 16%, only 6% have a correct SPF records. The other contained errors or had soft fail. So this is stuff that's been out there for a very, very, very long time. It's not complicated to set up. Still, people don't get it right. Anyone from PostNode in here? No? Sorry. I try to do that on every occasion I can. Because basically, if you look at postnode.com, if you have your clients up, do a dig. Tell me what you see. I'll tell you what they see. They'll see postnode.com actually announced an SPF record that tells people that over 100,000 email IP addresses can mail as postnode.com. Who was the main perpetrator behind the forged email 2016-2017? PostNode. What did they end their SPF record with? We don't know. They have a question mark all, which basically says, well, these are the 110 or 114,000 IP addresses that can mail as postnode.com. But just to be sure, we really don't know. It could be more. so you should let anybody else email at postnode.com as well. That's what I call a double facepalm, basically. So why could anybody forge email from my domain, from corp.com? How is that possible? Well, basically, the first try was SPF. We semi-failed, I'd say, with 6%, kind of. Well, yes, another standard came along. This is actually a mix between two, domain key and DKIM came out of that. Basically, it's rather clever. On the MTA side, on the sending side, you create a public key and a private key. You keep the private key to yourself. You publish the public key in DNS. You use the private key to sign certain headers of the RFC 5322 body, so to say. So this is DKIM signature. What it gives us is a perfect opportunity when I receive email, I can actually check the signature by retrieving the public key from DNS and just say, okay, so this is what he's been checksumming or signing, and just basically check the signature. So, perfect, isn't it? So, really good. It ensures that the D domain part of the DKIM signature is the same as the from address. We store the public key in DNS, the world's largest database, as Amel used to say. It's true, I love DNS. So, yep, and if you want to check it on your own, basically you need two parts. You need to know the domain, obviously, but you also need to know the selector. So if you have the selector and you can only get it if you get an email from me or from the domain you're interested in, you basically just do a dig on the selector, dot underscore domain key, dot domain, and you will actually get out the public key. Easy. Easy, easy. So any issues with this? You're silent today. Huh? Well, here's what I was crying about initially. We have the RFC 5321 mail from up here. Yeah. We have RFC 5322 from down there. You all seen it. Well, are you're beginning to see the light now, or the problems, or the clouds. SPF only restricts RFC 5321. DKIM only checks the RFC 5322 from. Here be dragons. This is clearly a problem. This is also a double facepalm. You're supposed to be laughing here. Good. So, at the third attempt, we're getting somewhere. How many in here is deploying a DMARC policy? One, two, three, four, five, six. How many of you still is at P equals none? Okay, how long have you been there? Okay. Are you looking at the reports? Okay, we'll get more into that later. Okay. DMARC checks the SPF results. Check. So DMARC in itself is just basically a subset of two different standards, and it adds a snitch part of it to it. DMARC checks the DKIM result, and it actually compares the RFC 5321 from and the RFC 5322 from. If they match or semi-match, you can have a relaxed or strict check, but they still have to be the correct apex of the domain, but you could have example.corp.com if you're doing a relaxed check. So in this case, DMARC will look for a match, and this two won't match. So this is a DMARC fail. So we could actually stop this crappy email at our external border. Wouldn't this be perfect? Yeah. The problem is we still need to make sure that our customers deploy DMARC. And you can do it in a sane way, and we'll get into that as well. DMARC the snitch, this is my favorite part. Built into the protocol is also reporting. So this is how you check a DMARC record. So, well, first you have like a version identification, then you have your policy. So if the DMARC checks fails, XPD tells people that you should reject email that purports to be from XPD.sc. If it doesn't pass the DMARC check, you can throw it away. We don't care because it's not from us. The other part is, if you, when you have received emails from us, either if they're successful or failed, please send an aggregate report to this address. So every, typically, the default is actually once per day. So once per day, there will actually be an XML, zipped XML file with reports coming into these addresses from all over the world. The cool part about this is it will give your customers insight into how their domain is used without them being involved. So if you have a DMARC record published for Volvo, and someone in Brazil is trying to send phishing emails to someone in Australia, actually, in Australia, if someone is using DMARC, they will actually report that back to Volvo. A situation that was completely undetectable before. So this is the third really, really good thing with DMARC. DMARC the snitch is your friend. If you either you purchase services like I do, a lazy guy, or you can write it yourself, there's some code out there to do this. This is actually purchase service I buy from a company called DMARCian in Hollands. And you get really nice stuff regarding your email flow. And this is also an IOC, more or less. So for this customer, all of a sudden, on this day, they had 2,700 rejected emails. So that was a phishing campaign. So it also gives you other insight that you could feedback to your ICE team or log team or ops team or SOC. So DMARC is good. The reporting stuff also makes it possible for you to roll out DMARC in a sane way. Yep. So the recommendations are ensure that you move all third-party senders. I'm quite sure that you don't have any third-party senders on your domains, but your customers most likely have UPSIS or someone else emailing out newsletters or anything from them. Don't do that. Stop doing that. Move them from the customer's domain, volvo.se, to upsys.volvo.se. And ensure that you have a clean SPF on the OPEX. Only you and your employees should be able to mail from your OPEX of your domain. Set up DMARC reporting and use it. Monitor it, because it will give you benefits that you didn't have before. Do a phased rollout of DMARC. It's in the protocol. You can publish a policy of none, keep it like that for a couple of months or a year, and watch the reports coming in. It will help you with what? It can help you adjust. Yeah. So you might have forgotten that you have, our GitLab server actually also sends out email. He needs to either be reconfigured to send it through our main smart host we need to add him to the SPF records. We need to add DKI IAM signing to that host. So the reporting, the policy none, use that to gather data on your legal traffic. And then you can roll out quarantine, and there you can actually in the protocol say that how many of the emails should be judged by the policy. And you start with 1%. You go to 50% after 2 weeks, you use 50% quarantine for 2 weeks, and then you go to 100% quarantine for 2 weeks. And then you move to 1% reject, 50% reject, 100% react, and then you're in there. It'll take you 3 months, but it'll give you a clean exit. Oh, I gave that away, huh? Trust issues. So, can anyone give me the name of a CA that they would trust? Come on, let's encrypt, huh? A C that you wouldn't trust. Diginotar. Anything else? How's your memory? Hadn't heard of that one. I was thinking of Symantec. Does it ring a bell? And the worst of them all. Yeah, they're really not bad, more bad than Komodo, but Komodo is, yeah. These guys went bankrupt. These guys were thrown out of the trust route from Chrome and were bought up by DigiCert. These guys are still selling certificates very, very cheaply. Why? Why didn't they file for bankruptcy? Too big to fail. Basically, these guys were the ones that had a hacker issue star.com certificates. And at that time, when it was revealed, they were issuing 25% of all the SSL certificates in the world. So they were just too big to fail. Avoid at all costs. So meet Dane, or TLSA, I'd say. Jakob isn't here today, no? Okay. I usually tend to point to him for questions because he was part of writing this standard. So Dane or TLSA is more or less just a way that you can publish your CA in DNS. So what is more sane for you as a customer, trust Komodo or Symantec or Thought that your bank's certificate is correct? Or is it more sensible for you to actually trust your bank that they say that this certificate is signed by a CA that we trust? Most likely the last part. So that's TLSA. You can do a bunch of other cool stuff with TLSA. You can do publish PGP keys, SMIME keys. CAA. How many in here has a CAA record? Come on, two. Okay, cool. So CAA is basically a way that you tell any CA that's part of CA browser forum that this is a gentleman check. They're basically you publish what CAs can be used to issue certificates for my organization. It costs you nothing to set up, check certificate transparency. If you're unsure what CAs you're using, set it up, make sure that you add a snitch address. Basically, the CAs are required to mail to this address if someone else is trying to issue a certificate for your customer or your organization. CAA, quite easy to set up. How many in here hates DNSSEC? At least one, okay. We have quite a nice adoption rate in Sweden. I like DNSSEC. I don't mind other solutions, but I think it makes sense to do something that you can trust DNS data. DNSSEC is actually not mandatory for most of the stuff I talked about, but it's really, really recommended. The future, or actually almost here already, I think the two top parts are actually already RFCs, the MTA, STS, the TLS, RPT. The two below ones require TLS and ARC is still in draft, I think. So MTA, STS, this is another way of ensuring that you only get encrypted email. This could get away with the start TLS problem. So basically, you publish a policy in DNS, and then you publish a file, a text file, at a well-known place. Thank you. That basically tells you what mode and what server. And with this way, you could actually get away with. This is a way to combat the man-in-the-middle problem we talked about earlier. The TLS RPT goes hand-in-hand with that, because if I, as a sender, can't establish SSL to your server, I need a way to snitch. I need a way to tell you that someone is probably trying to fuck up the traffic between us. This one is interesting. It requires TLS. It's still in draft. It's announced by the server. On the mail client, you'll add the required TLS verb. And this basically tells your MTA that I absolutely need to have transport layer encryption all the way from my edge to the other edge. This is nice stuff. ARC is a way to try to get around problems with DMARC. So obvious problems with DMARC is, for example, forwarding of email or mailing lists. State of the nation, or state of Sweden. This is from Hardenice. Anybody not familiar with Hardenice? This is Ivan Ristic stuff. Ivan wrote most of the SSL tests for SSL labs, Qualsys. So this is his new project. It's really, really nice. And you can see the sorry state of Sweden is here, that only 20% of the web servers of the 800 monitored organizations are in a good state, but only 50% of the mail servers are in a good state. So this is for Sweden. This is data from Hardenice. 93% support start TLS, 83% SPF of these 800 domains that's been put in there. Should I just be standing like this? Huh? Only 13% of those 800, are typically financial institutions, banks, governments, etc. 13% supports DMARC and 1% Dane. So this is the Hardenice report on a Swedish government agency. It should not look like this. This is utter crap. I'm doing something wrong. It should look like this. And if you haven't tried, you should absolutely try your own domain there. Should I take one of those instead?
This is not governed by an RFC, by
by decision. You have DNS over SSH, DNS over TTS, DNS over Quick. So that's just quickly to address. I think DNS over TLS, for example, is supported by Cloudflare. So if you want privacy for your DNS queries, either if it's your MTA or you're just your own resolver, just forward queries to Cloudflare. So the action plan. Should I do like this? It's a good thing I'm an old sergeant.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll probably use my voice. It's fine.
No.
Yeah. So I'd say this. Implement regular security awareness training for your users. I am not kidding. You should really do it. This is halfway through the solution. Use excellent stuff like GoFish. If you haven't tried it, it's a wonderful tool to train your users. You can use it to launch email phishing campaigns against your employees. You'll have a measurement of how many that click the links, open the emails, enter their credentials. If you harden your users by using this type of campaign, it will be much more less likely to push that wrong URL that comes to other users. Implement the correct SPF. Sign your public zones, DNSSEC. We can have a fight later. Implement PKIM. Implement DMARC. Do the phase rollout I talked about earlier. Publish DNSSEC records, at least for your end servers. Publish EAA records. Using DMARC in Office 365. Office 365 is kind of nice. They actually pre-publish a lot of the stuff you need. And the major problem is, two things to think about. For Office 365, your policy of reject or quarantine is the same. They don't reject, they always quarantine. That's kind of good, anyway. The default setup of PKIM will fail. Of course, DMARC fails if you don't adjust it. Because basically what they are signing is company name dot on Microsoft.com. And that will most likely not be your phone domain. It will validate DKIM wise, SPF will work, but DMARC will spot the difference and will say this is a hard DMARC. And you can read on that over here, exactly how to do it, on the list of read it. That's a good catch. Easy. Low hanging fruit. Sorry, I think I'm almost done in time. Hooray!